again to be a part of it. I think I have had this privilege a couple of times earlier, and I would like to thank Professor Vivek Srivastava for having taken this initiative and co-opted me for this program. So thank you. So I'll start with my presentation and just a second. Share. So, is it visible? Are the slides visible now? Vaishnav,
Yes, sir,
can you see the
it
slides?
is visible,
Okay.
sir.
Okay. So this subject is power system reliability, and I've used primarily two reference textbook. One is by Roy Billington, Reliability Evaluation of Power Systems, published by Springer, and the other book is by Indrani, Reliability Modeling in Electric Power Systems. So these are the principal reference books. Besides this, there is another book by Roy Billington, which is on calculations. So, it's a mixture of the various topics in this presentation. So a little bit on the definition and the basic idea of what exactly is power system reliability. I'm not going to speak much on what exactly is reliability, because that is something which we have already covered in detail. So typically, reliability is applied to mission-oriented systems. For a non-reliable, non-repairable reliability function is given as this. That means the operating time, that means the time to failure is greater than the operating time that you are interested in, or the mission time. So in the context of power system, it essentially means to provide an adequate supply of electrical energy. So this is basically implied by power system reliability. That means you are in a position to adequately provide electrical energy. Okay, so in this concept of power system reliability, it's basically very broad in its coverage, and it covers a little more in detail about the ability of the power system to perform its intended function. Primarily, it's basically to provide an adequate supply of electrical energy. So let's look at it a little more in detail, especially in the context of power systems. The function of an electric power system is to satisfy the system load requirements as economically as possible and reasonable assurance of continuity and quality. So I am sure that you understand the basic intent. You have a certain load, and of course, there is a load, and then there is a generation and a transmission system so that you are able to meet the system load. So the function of the electric power system to satisfy the system load requirements as economically as possible. That means it should be optimal in a sense, and with assurance of continuity and quality. Quality in terms of voltage, frequency, and so on, and continuity without disruption. So there is a load, there is a generation transmission, the capacity to be able to meet the load with assurance of continuity without disruption and meeting the quality standards. So system reliability, basically we look at it in two different ways. One is system adequacy and the other is system security. So it has a very wide range of meanings, primarily the power system reliability, and especially it covers system adequacy and system security. So In system adequacy, it relates to the existence of sufficient facilities within the system to satisfy the consumer load demand or system operational constraints. Okay, so you have a certain load demand, and then you have sufficient facilities in terms of various units, generating units, and then transmission lines, and then you can meet certain operational constraints. So adequacy relates to the load demand, the generation facilities being able to meet the load demand or system operational constraints. So that's adequacy, to be able to meet the load demand. You know, the facilities are able to meet the load demand. That's system adequacy. That's an aspect of power system reliability. So adequacy is therefore associated with static conditions which do not include system dynamic and transient disturbances. So unlike security, it relates to static conditions. You know, operational constraints are hard, then load requirement is hard, it doesn't change, you know, per se. And therefore, the facilities to be able to meet the load requirement refers to adequacy. This is what is implied by power system reliability. Another aspect of power system reliability is the security, which relates to the ability of the system to respond to dynamic or transient disturbances arising within the system. So, you know, the frequency, voltage changes, and so on, the changing requirements, they relate to security issues. So because of which there can be a downtime. So adequacy and security. So I will now come back to adequacy. These studies are conducted in each of the three power system functional zones. So we divide the entire power supply system into three aspects of study. One is the generating facilities, the transmission facilities, and the distribution facilities. So we refer to this functional zone of generation facilities as hierarchical level one, then generation and transmission combination as hierarchical level two. And then when you combine it with distribution as well, then it is hierarchical level three, HL3, HL2, HL1. HL1 is simply the generation, HL2 is generation plus transmission, HL3 is generation, transmission, and distribution. Now, most of the studies that you would find today in the literature and most of the books on power system reliability, they largely focus in the area of adequacy. That means the facility should be able to meet the load required. And therefore, various indices have been developed which relate to the adequacy. And this is not a complete picture of the reliability indices, because if you need to cover security, there will be some different kind of indices. So therefore, most of the studies today you'll find largely in the area of adequacy, okay? That means the facilities, generation, transmission, distribution, be able to meet the load required. Now, there are three fundamental parameters in the calculation of system adequacy. So we are looking at the adequacy indices. One is the frequency of events, the duration of events, the severity of events, okay? So maybe the frequencies, the duration, the severity. These three things have to be explored in detail as far as the system adequacy indices are concerned, and we'll see subsequently how they can be evaluated. There can be some other approaches. One is the analytical approach. So you represent the entire system by a mathematical model. So that's quite complex. And then evaluate the reliability indices from this model using some analytical solutions. Then Monte Carlo simulation approach, which estimates reliability indices by simulating the actual process and random behavior of the system, treats the problem as a series of real experiments. So Monte Carlo simulation, analytical approach, and of course, the approach that we mentioned regarding the evaluation of adequacy. Okay, why is it important to carry out reliability studies? You know, the bottom line is, how much does it cost to get a reliable power supply? How much does it cost to have adequate supply, you know, to be able to meet the load requirements? So the basic idea is, how much would it cost per unit power to be able to meet the requirements? So there is a common underlying relationship which motivates all the reliability related decision. That is the reliability improvements which result in fewer failures. What is implied by reliability? That means when you say reliable power supply, that means the various components which are there in generation, transmission, distribution, they should have fewer failures. More the failures, there'll be more disruption, more downtime, and therefore, you know, less power generated, and therefore higher cost. There is a certain load, and then you have, then you don't have so much of generation. So because of the downtimes, you will have, will experience costs of failures, and therefore it will increase the operating costs. So we typically, when we look at the cost relation to reliability, if the reliability of the system is high, you would basically have to spend less. You would have to spend less. The operating costs would be much less, because you would experience much fewer failures. The system is reliable, and therefore the operating cost is going to be low. But for getting a reliable power supply, that means probably having more units, and then more capacities, and then probably having you know, more reliable transmission distribution network. So it is going to increase the investment on the infrastructure, on the facilities. So typically, if you want more reliability, you would have more, you would need more investment into the facilities, although the operating costs can be low. But the total cost, you know, the total cost would be the investment cost as well as the operating cost. And therefore, you see there is an optimum. So if you want a higher reliability than the optimal, than the optimal reliability, then it's going to cost you more. If you look for a lower reliability, thinking that you are going to save money and save money on investments, and your operating costs are going to be high, and therefore the total cost, you know, per unit is going to be high. So you would basically have an optimal cost or a minimal cost for a certain value of reliability. So reliability is very much related to the cost, to the bottom line, to the profits, and therefore it is very important to study the subject of reliability in the context of power system and how it impacts the unit costs. Okay. Now, operating costs, you know, if you look at the operating costs, it includes the cost of failures, which includes customer interruption, cost of equipment damage, cost of penalties associated with violating the reliability criteria. So that's the operating cost. Then you have investment costs, you know, which are typically in the form of cost for installation, additional equipments like generation, transmission, or distribution equipment. So investment costs are related to the facilities. And so operating costs are typically in the form of increased production costs caused by off-optimal dispatch or increased maintenance. So if you try to cut down on the operating costs, so you would end up, if you try to cut down on the costs, you would end up in increasing the maintenance, you know, you would increasing the maintenance, and therefore the overall expenses are going to be higher. So we saw that there was an optimal point, which is mentioned as X. So this is an optimal point. Beyond this optimal point, you see cost of failure, the operating costs, beyond, I mean, more than this reliability, the operating costs may be low, but the investment costs are going to be high. Lesser the reliability than the optimal reliability, you would find that the investment costs may be low, but the operating costs may be higher, and therefore the total cost may be high. So this is an optimal point. So reliability related decisions may be classified by problem type according to the following. So when you are looking at reliability related decisions, you know, that means in terms of operational needs, planning. Therefore, we need to look at the following. One is the operational adjustment, unit commitment, and the maintenance. Operational adjustment essentially means to identify the trade-off between system reliability and operational adjustment, such as unit commitment, redispatch, switching, or load curtailment. You know, so the trade-off between the system reliability. Just as you saw that there was a cost trade-off. You know, you want minimum cost, and therefore the reliability corresponding to it. If you go in for a higher reliability, you end up more cost. If you go in for a lower reliability, you end up more cost. So, you know, so likewise, you can have these operational adjustments with unit commitment, redispatch, switching, load curtailment. So those are operational adjustments. Likewise, unit commitment, identify the trade-off between system reliability and unit commitment. You know, if you are not willing to make too many commitments as far as the generation is concerned, that means you are looking for a lower reliability, and therefore you may end up losing load and so on. And therefore there is a kind of trade-off between the system reliability and unit commitment. Likewise for maintenance, maintain equipment so as to maximize the improvement in overall reliability, maintaining cost, time and resource, manpower and so on. And therefore, but this would have an advantage in the overall reliability. So therefore, how much are you willing to trade off with respect to maintenance? Do you do an overkill, have a lot of maintenance to maintain a high reliability, or you prefer to maintain less and then have a lower reliability? So there is a kind of trade-off there. Then facility enhancement, reinforce the system through installing new equipment. You have more generators, you have more transmission lines, distribution lines, and so on. So increase the capacity, and therefore it costs money. And therefore you may be able to supply the load, but at what cost? So there is some kind of trade-off which you have to do with reliability there as well. So the reliability related decisions can be connected, associated with operational adjustment, unit commitment, maintenance, facility enhancement. So the traditional power system terminology uses operational and planning to distinguish short-term decision problems. Short-term decision problems with respect to operational requirement and long-term decision problems associated with planning. So a slight refinement to this would be to distinguish short-term problems from mid-term decision problems and long-term. Okay, so operational is short-term decision horizon ranging from minutes to days or weeks. Operational horizon is short-term. Minutes to days or weeks. Operational planning is mid-term horizon. So from few days to 1 or 2 years, then planning is long-term decision horizon exceeding 1 or 2 years, typically in the range of 3 to 10 years. Okay, so when we look at reliability, we connect it to operational horizon, operational planning horizon, and planning horizon as well. Okay, because everything costs money, and therefore you cannot compromise on the reliability as well. and therefore you need to do some kind of trade-off, and therefore you need to plan for it, you know. So there can be operational planning, which can be range from a few minutes to days or weeks. Operational planning, mid-term, short-term operational planning, mid-term, from extending from days to 1 or 2 years, and long-term, exceeding more than 1 or 2 years, typically in the range of 3 to 10 years. So reliability related decisions, you know, I mentioned about the operational planning and the plan. Planning relates to the facility enhancement. You want to, you know, deploy more generating capacity, you know, enhance the transmission lines and the distribution facilities and so on. The operational planning in terms of maintenance and the operational requirements with respect to both unit commitment and operational adjustments. So you can see the horizon range extending from a few minutes to a few days in terms of operational, and the operational planning from few days extending up to 2 years, and then more than 1 or 2 years extending, say, even up to 10 years or beyond is long-term plan. Now, reliability evaluations, of course, have to do with failures, you know, because after all, we are talking about a technical system, and technical system consists of all kinds of equipment, and therefore there can be failures. Now, failures, and which can lead to certain uncertainties, you know, then you don't know how much you are going to generate, how much of load will be served, and so on. So these are various types of uncertainties we are going to look at. One is the operating conditions, the contingencies, and the operator action. So the operating conditions related to the decision horizon, small variations about a forecasted operating condition. Planning horizon, large variations about forecasted sequential trajectory. So when you are looking at planning horizon, we are looking at large variations about, you know, it have to forecast what will be the need in terms of generation, how the load is going to increase, and so on. So there can be more uncertainty there, okay? And then, so one type of uncertainty is due to the operating conditions, then due to the contingencies, you know, which can be weather dependent. You know, if you have a stormy weather, or if you have some disruption due to thunderstorm, lightning, so on. So weather-dependent probabilities, this will introduce a certain kind of uncertainty in the reliability evaluation, which can be factored in to a certain extent, but still there'll be some uncertainty there. And then the planning decision horizon, there'll be static probabilities because we are looking at long-term. Then operator action, part of the decision not modeled in the evaluation, modeled in the evaluation. So operator action, contingency, operating conditions. These are basically the sources of uncertainty in the reliability, which factor into the reliability evaluations. So we come to the reliability indices. For example, the hierarchical level one reliability. If we go back to the slides, you'll see that what we discussed as hierarchical level one was the generation facilities. Hierarchical level two was the generation plus the transmission facilities. And hierarchical level three, the generation, transmission, and distribution facilities. And therefore, we are going to look at those reliability indices which relate to hierarchical level one, that means generation, hierarchical level two, that means generation plus transmission, and level three, generation plus transmission and distribution. So we are going to look a little more into level one. So what is the modeling approach? So you have a generation model and the load model, and they're combined to form probabilistic risk or adequacy index. So you have a generation, level one is generation, but then you have a load requirement, and therefore whether the generation is able to meet the load requirement, and to model it as a probabilistic indices. So they are referred to as adequacy indices. What are the chances that you'll be able to meet the load requirement? Okay, so we have load and generation. Generation is level one. So here the basic generation model is a capacity outage priority table. So the uncertainty here, which primarily affects the reliability, is if the generating capacity, if there are outages. Outages means failures. So if some unit is out and is unable to provide the generation, or is unable to provide meet the load, you know. So you have a capacity outage. 20 megawatt is out, 30 megawatt is out. So you are left with 70 megawatt or 100 megawatt. So there is a certain outage which can be expected. So the load model can be, so that's the generation. So modeling the generation, modeling the load. Generation being modeled as capacity outage priority table. That means what are the probability that a certain capacity will not be available. So that's the generation table, capacity outage priority table. Then you have the generation and then you have the load. The load model can be modeled either as daily peak load variation curve, you know, how the peak load varies over the entire day, which includes peak loads of each day, or the load duration curve, which represents hourly variations of the load. One can be hourly variation, and then the other can be on a daily basis, the peak load variation. So that's the load model, and there is the generation model. And then you combine together to get a risk model, okay? Okay, yeah. So you have a generation model, you have a load model, and sometimes due to uncertainties, due to outages, it may not be able to meet the load. And load also has a variation. Daily peak load variation, and then, you know, it has variations. And therefore, there is a certain chance that the generation and the load, the generation may not be able to meet the load. And therefore, that can be modeled by the risk. So that is the risk, the probability that a certain load will not be met by the generating systems. So the basic indices reflect the probability, frequency, or duration of losing load. So what are the chance that there'll be loss of load? What is the frequency of occurrence? And what would be the duration of losing the load? Okay, this does not, the level one indices do not talk about the amount of load lost, okay, which is reflected in the severity-based indices. You remember those transitory influences in terms of duration of losing load and amount of load lost. They are handled by the security-based indices, severity-based indices. So you have the adequacy and you have the severity. So adequacy largely relates to the probability, frequency, or duration of losing load, but not the amount of load lost. So it is typically advantageous in any given study to obtain at least one basic index and at least one severity based index. So you have plenty of indices. We'll look at some of them only, and we'll be able to see it only in the context of time that is available and the depth to which we can go. So we'll look at some of the indices, basic indices, the adequacy indices, which relates to the probability, duration, and frequency. Likewise, the severity indices, which takes into account the amount of load lost, and then the probability, frequency, and duration associated with it. Now, level one indices, that means the generation. Generation facility to be able to meet the load. Okay, so probability of system failure. I mentioned about probability, frequency, and the duration. Okay, so probability of system failure, this is the probability of time in the long run when a system failure condition exists. Okay, so proportion of time in which there is a system failure exists. So that's denoted by PF. So that's the probability of system failure. Expected frequency of losing load. This is the frequency of stays in or entry into a system failure state, denoted as FF. So you have PF, which relates to the probability of system failure. Then expected frequency of losing load, that is F. Then average duration of losing load, expected amount of time for stay in the failure state. So these are the level one indices which relate to the generation facility. Okay, and we call it level one indices. So let's discuss about two of these indices. For example, the loss of load expectation, which gives the expected number of days in a year in which a loss of load occurs. You know, expected number of days in which there'll be loss of load. So average duration gives time per stay. So how long does the loss of load last? So that's the average duration of per stay. The LOLE gives cumulative times per year. So the loss of load expectation gives the expected number of days in a year, the cumulative number of days in a year in which the loss of load occurs. The loss of the load requirement is not met. What is the number of days over which the load requirement is not met? Cumulative number. So loss of load expectation. Likewise, probability of losing load, loss of load probability, LOL. The loss of load probability is the probability of system failure under the assumption that the peak load of each day lasts all day. So if there is a, you know, there is a load variation, we have discussed about that while discussing the generation, modeling the generation and modeling the load, we have discussed about the load variation. And therefore, that means when there is a variation in the load, that means that sometimes there will be a peak load. Okay, so here while calculating the probability of loss, probability of losing load, or loss of load probability, we assume that the peak load lasts all throughout the day. So we take the worst condition in terms of the load and then be able to see whether the generation is able to meet that load requirement or not. So it is then expressed as the number of days per year that the load will not be met. So in a year, if the peak load lasts all throughout the day, so in a year, how many number of days on the average will not be able to meet the load? If the peak load lasts all day, so over a year, how many days the load requirement will not be met? So that is LOL. So one is per day, and then you multiply it by 365, it gives over the entire day. Now let's look at severity-based indices. You know, severity-based indices is expected unserved demand per year. You know, some demand is not met with. So there is a certain load requirement. Some of it is met, some of it is not met. So on the average, what is the unserved demand per year? Unserved energy per year, expected energy per year. And then system minutes. So on the whole, if you look at the generation and load, so on the whole, you know, for how long can you say in a year there has been a system failure? So in terms of system failure, in terms of minutes. So the last severity-based index, system minutes, is perhaps the only one which needs to be explained. This index gives the total energy not served per year in terms of an equivalent number of minutes per year for which a demand equal to the peak load will be interrupted. Okay, so number of minutes per year for which the demand, we assume that the demand is the peak load, you know, would be interrupted. How long would it be interrupted in a year in terms of minutes? So that's system minutes. So when we look at severity based indices, we are looking at expected unserved demand per year, then unserved energy and system minutes. Now, let's look at some small example. Consider total energy not served per year for a system having 6,000 megawatt peak load. Okay, is let's say that the total energy not served is 1,000 megawatt hour. Then how do you calculate the system minutes? So unserved is 1,000 megawatt per hour, and then peak load is 6,000 megawatt. So 1,000 divided by 6,000 multiplied by 60 minutes, you know, per hour. In 1 hour, you are saying 1,000 megawatt, and then 6,000 megawatt is being generated. 1,000 is not being served in an hour. 6,000 in an hour is being generated, and therefore it translates to 10 system minutes, which means that 1,000 megawatt hour unserved energy over 1 year is equivalent to a situation where the system has a complete blackout for 10 minutes during its peak load period. If there is a peak load, there will be complete blackout for 10 minutes. So this is an important index as far as the severity is concerned. So you take the peak load and you take the energy not served. So the ratio of the two multiplied by 60, it gives you the system minutes. So that was HL level one. You know, we discussed about level one, both adequacy as well as severity indices. Level two indices. Common indices for composite generation and transmission reliability include the same ones for HL1 analysis with a set of load point or delivery point indices seen by each individual network mode. The presence of the network model allows the computation of load point indices. So common load point indices are similar to basic and severity based indices. So the load point indices are very similar to HL1, except that they are computed on a per bus basis rather than per system basis. So there we were computing it on a per system, but here you take the network and for every bus you find out what is the severity. Okay, so it's a per bus basis. Another type of index that is unique to HL2 analysis are the failure probabilities, frequency and duration. So this is kind of used everywhere. Probabilities, frequency and duration of outage associated with specific network conditions. So we are looking at a network here, isn't it? HL2 is generation plus transmission. So generation plus transmission means the network combined with transmission network along with the generation. So there can be certain network conditions which can be circuit overload and bus voltage out of limits. So under such conditions, what are the probabilities of the load being not served, you know, on every bus? What is the frequency of these outages and what is the duration? What is the duration of these outages? So this is HL2 indices, which is composite, generation and transmission. So HL1 analysis together with a set of load point or delivery point indices seen by each individual network unit. Okay, so I think we'll take a 15 minutes break and come back. I think you must be 3:30 there. So we'll come back at 3:45 to begin again. Is that okay? Vaishnav? Hello, Vaishnav?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, we'll take a 15 minutes break and come back.
Okay, sir.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you. Take care.
I think speaker is muted.
Sir, sir has taken a 15-minute break.
We are having a 15 minutes break. I mentioned about it. We are having a 15 minutes break and we'll be back at your time. I think it would be eight o'clock time.
Yeah, it's around 8 p.m. here.
Yeah. So we'll be back after 15 minutes break. So at 8 o'clock, your time, we'll be back. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Hi, can we begin? Hello? Hello,
yes,
can we
sir.
Begin? Yeah, so can you see the slides?
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Okay, so we've done with the hierarchical level one slides, and we were hierarchical level one indices. Now we are basically discussing indices for hierarchical level two, that means generation plus transmission. So if I go back and show you again, you know, to get you a recap, just a sec. Yeah, so this was hierarchical level one. You remember loss of load probability, loss of load expectation, then the severity indices, frequency, probability, duration, for all the three of them, you know, the amount of load lost. So those severity indices we discussed, and the adequacy indices for the generation facilities is level one indices. Now we are looking at level two, that means generation and plus transmission. That means there is a network. That means over in the network, there are several buses, but over the buses, you can have some load losses and things of that kind. Therefore, that needs to be factored in. So we were basically looking at level two indices, common indices for composite generation and transmission, which includes some indices for level one with a set of load point or delivery point indices seen by each individual network node. Okay, so common load point indices are similar to the basic and severity indices as in H1 analysis, except that they are now computed on a per bus basis rather than a per system basis. You remember in terms of system minutes, we had discussed about the severity indices, but here we are basically looking at per bus, not the whole system as per se. In the previous case, level one, we just had the generation. Now you have the generation plus the transmission, and therefore you are going to look at every bus. Okay, so another type of index that is unique to HL2 analysis are the failure probabilities, frequencies, and duration associated with specific network conditions such as circuit overload and bus voltage out of limits. So when you are looking at every bus, then the issues that would concern you, in the earlier case, you are just looking at the generation. You are not looking at the transmission, looking at the ability of the generation to be able to meet the load and so on. But now you are having a transmission, therefore you are having a network, therefore you are having several buses. So there are certain network conditions which you need to take into account, like circuit overload and bus voltage out of limits. So, okay, so the indices which are relevant to hierarchical level two are the failure probabilities, frequencies, and duration. Now, one question which must be, you know, worrying, which must be worrying you is, what are the uses of reliability indices? We cannot discuss everything in detail, but I can tell you broadly under relative use and absolute use. So in relative use, you can compare one alternative, one facility to another, you know, in terms of system minutes, for example, or compare one operating condition to another in terms of loss of load expectation. Okay, so there is a relative use. We want to compare one alternative with another alternative in a relative sense. So we may be able to compare one operating condition to another in terms of loss of load expectation, or one facility plan in terms of with another in terms of system minutes. So that's the relative use. What about the absolute use? So obviously, when you're looking at absolute use, you are also looking at a threshold value of index. And then either the facility passes or fails. So you have fixed a threshold in terms of probably loss of load probability, or in terms of system minutes or in terms of duration. And then you want to compare whether your facility is able to either pass or fail with respect to that threshold. So there is a relative use, and then there is an absolute use. So what is the scheme for calculation of reliability indices for hierarchical level 2? You know that there is a network, and network means that means there are several buses and then delivery points, and then there are generation, there is generation. So you can expect either of these two things to be out. So there is an outage selection. You can basically look at every outage. So there is an outage, and then something is out, maybe a transmission or a generation facility. Then you want to see whether the operating conditions are violated or not. So for example, whether the line flows in limits, so whether the voltage and the current requirements are not violated. So you check for those with respect to a certain outage. And if it is not flowing in limits, so that means you need to do some generation rescheduling. And then again, you check if the line flows in limits. If it is yes, then you go for another outage. Your another outage, generation plus transmission or generation or transmission and so on, various combinations. So then if after generation rescheduling also, if you see that the line flow is violated, that means it doesn't flow in the limits, then obviously you need to do some load curtailment. So that means at the delivery points, you need to be able to contain the load, reduce the load at the delivery point. But what should be the load curtailment cannot be handled in a very simple way. It has to use a optimization algorithm. So load curtailment, through an algorithm, through a software, you can basically come out with what should be the load curtailed on every bus, and then accordingly calculate the reliability index. So as you can see, that this is not a very simple thing, and it has to be handled very elaborately in a very detailed way by software. Now, what are the level 2 indices for adequacy? Probability of load curtailment. What are the chances that the load will be curtailed on a bus? Expected number of load curtailments. Expected duration. Number means you are referring basically then to the frequency. So probability, frequency, duration, then average duration of load curtailment, expected demand not supplied, expected energy not supplied, bulk power interruption index, bulk power energy curtailment index, modified bulk energy curtailment index, and severity index. So you get a whole lot of indices. Other than the level 1 indices, which are not too many, both for adequacy and severity, but here you end up getting more because you also had expected energy not served, bulk power interruption index, then you also have
can I request you kindly put it into the presentation mode?
It's not in the presentation mode?
No, sir. It is in the normal PPT mode.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So you have a whole lot of adequacy indices, level 2 indices. Okay. Because you have transmission and generation. Okay. So you have several delivery points. So obviously you are worried about to be able to handle the uncertainties. What will be the load curtailment on each of the bus, and you don't want to curtail too much. So you want to kind of run some minimization algorithm to figure out, without violating the constraints, what should be the minimum load curtailment on various buses. Okay. and then what will be accordingly the what will accordingly be the indices in terms of priority, expected number, duration, expected demand not supplied, expected energy not supplied, bulk power interruption index. You know, you remember system minutes we were talking about. So here you are looking at bulk power interruption index, bulk power energy curtailment index, modified bulk energy curtailment index, severity index. So as far as hierarchical level 2 indices are concerned, we are looking at reliability indices evaluation. One is in the annualized mode, the other is the annual indices. Annualized indices basically means that there is a single fixed load level over a period of 1 year. You know, you remember there we were looking at LOLP and things like that, and that means the peak load lasts throughout the year and so on. So we are basically looking at annualized indices calculated for a single fixed load level over a period of 1 year. Annual indices calculated using load duration curve. So the load varies on a daily basis, and then, you know, over the year there is a certain variation. So if you are looking at the variation of the load, then it is annual indices. If you are taking fixed load levels over a period of 1 year, then it is annualized indices. So these indices can be looked at in two different ways. One is annualized fixed load, and the other is using a load duration curve. So annual indices reflect the reliability of a particular system in a more realistic manner. So the annual indices, which basically take into account the variation of the load, the variation of the load over the day and over various days and so on. So it reflects the reliability of a practical system naturally in a more realistic way, because it takes into account the variation. But annualized indices are sufficient when you are comparing two systems. So you have one facility, you have another facility, and you want to make a relative comparison. So you need not have to go into a detailed annual indices. Naturally, this is going to be much more complex to evaluate, and therefore you need not really go into annual indices. You just want to compare two systems. So then you just only need to take annualized indices into account. So two types of indices: load point reliability indices and system reliability. So load point, you know, those delivery points in HL2. So you have load point reliability indices and system reliability indices. So we'll basically now go to the various indices per se. And as you understand, that trying to compute these is not very simple and straightforward. So we'll just give you a conceptual overview of what exactly they mean. And of course, you can get some idea about how they may be calculated. So adequacy indices, level 2, probability of load curtailment. Probability of load curtailment, that means probability of system state I, and S is the set of all system states associated with load curtailments. So there are various load curtailments at delivery points. You know, you have done some minimization, and then you find out what is the probability that these loads will be minimized, you know, on every delivery point. And therefore, you sum them up for all of them, and that gives you the probability of load curtailment. That gives you a systemic view, probability of load curtailment. So probability of system state and various states and all the system states associated with the load curtailments have to be factored into it to find out what is the probability of load curtailment. Then expected number of load curtailments. So expected number of load curtailments, which is the sum of the occurrences of the load curtailment states and is therefore an upper boundary of the actual frequency index. Okay, So you are basically having some load curtailment on the delivery points, and therefore, what is the sum of these total load curtailments, the average, the expected? So that's ENLs, expected number of load curtailment, which in some way relates to the expected frequency number, the expected number of load curtailment. Expected number of load curtailment, so in some way it relates to the frequency. So the system state frequency can be calculated by the following relationship between the frequency and the system state probability. So you have the probabilities of various states in which there are load curtailments, and you want to calculate the system frequency. We have earlier calculated the expected number of load curtailment. Now you want to compute the system frequency. So you have the failure rates associated with the various components. Okay, you have generation and you have transmission components. So, and then the various states in terms of various component failures that can happen, which can lead to load curtailments. So there is a probability associated with every state. And then you also have the failure rates. So you can calculate the system state frequency. Okay. So using the state probability and the failure rates. So this is the system frequency of occurrence per year. Okay. Then expected duration of load curtailment. That's the probability of load curtailment multiplied by the probability multiplied by the duration over a year. So in a year, you have 8,760 hours. You multiply that, you get expected duration of load curtailment. Like that, average duration of load curtailment. What is the average duration? So you take the expected duration and then expected frequency of load curtailment. Okay, so duration divided by the frequency will give you the average duration of load curtailment. And expected demand not supplied. So you take the load curtailments of various states of the system in which there are load curtailment, and so you multiply it by the probability, and that gives you the expected demand not supplied. So in a particular state, what is the load curtailment? In another state, you know, of some outage, if there is any outage, it results in a state of the system with a specific outage. So in various outages, you have multiple states of the system. So in every state of the system, there is some load curtailment. So you take the curtailment and then you multiply it by the probability of that curtailment. And therefore, expected demand not supplied can be computed this way. So this is a level two. You know, you are taking the buses in the network and you are taking the generation as well. So this tells you what is the expected demand not supplied if you take the network, if you take the generation system along with the transmission network. So expected energy not supplied. So you take the load curtailment in every state, the frequency of these occurrences and the duration. The frequencies, the duration, and the load curtailment, you multiply them and for every single state, and then you sum them up, so that gives you expected energy not supplied. Then you have the bulk power interruption index. You know, you take the curtailment states and the frequencies of these occurrences, and then divide by the annual system peak load. So if you are looking at the whole system and then you are looking at the whole peak load, then the interruption index, you know, there you remember we were calculating those system minutes and so on. So you want to compute here bulk power interruption index. So you take these curtailments in every system state, multiplied by the frequencies of these states, and then divided by the annual system peak load in megawatt, that gives the bulk power interruption index. Then bulk power energy curtailment index. So likewise, expected energy not served. divided by the annual system peak load. That gives you the bulk power energy curtailment index. Okay, so that you multiply it by 60, that gives you the severity index. That means the whole system, it translates to the whole system being down for so many minutes in a year. You know, the entire system of transmission and generation system, which is a kind of blackout, you can see. You know, both the generation and the transmission taken together. So the severity index is simply trying to compute the system minutes in a year for which there will be no supply at all. So that's bulk power. That's the bulk power energy curtailment index multiplied by 60 system minutes in a year. Okay. Now, what about the load point reliability indices? I was telling you about the delivery points, the buses over which you have load curtailments. So at the load point, what are the indices? Because they relate to the transmission, you can say. One is the probability of failure, the frequency of failure, the expected load curtailment, and expected energy not supplied, you see. So these can all be computed if you are able to model the entire system with generation and transmission, and then try to find out the probability of these various states. Okay, probability of these various states. So these are probability of failure of these various states. Probabilities of failure of these various states can be computed. Then the frequency of failure can be computed. Then the expected load curtailment can be computed. Then the expected energy not supplied can be computed at the every single load point. So these are reliability indices which relate to the load point. Then what about system reliability indices? One is the bulk power supply disturbance. Then you have bulk power interruption index. Then you have, when you are looking at system, you are looking at both transmission and generation together. So bulk power system disturbance, bulk power interruption index, which we have seen earlier. Then you have bulk power energy curtailment index. Then you have modified bulk power curtailment, energy curtailment index. So these are system reliability indices. If you want to compare, you know, one facility with respect to another facility, you may like to look at system reliability indices. Then state probabilities and state frequencies, how do you compute? Everywhere you see they are used, you know, the one is the probability and the other is the frequency. So to be able to compute them, you basically model the entire system stochastically into a Markov model, and then look at the transitions from one state to another, and then find out the probabilities of various states, and then be able to compute the state probabilities and state frequencies. Both the state probabilities and the state frequencies can be computed. Okay, so I had discussed with you the hierarchical level 1 and the hierarchical level 2 indices. You know, and given you an idea about what kind of indices they are, both adequacy and severity indices. Now, we want to come back to level 1 indices and then discuss about, for example, hierarchical level 1, how the computation happens. Maybe one set of computations we can discuss because we would not have time for anything else. So we basically discuss the generation system reliability. You know, level 1, you are looking at the generation system. So this is essentially a capacity outage probability table. So there is certain capacity outage, and what is the probability of these outages? So what is the probability that a certain capacity would be there in the generation system? Because then you have to meet the load requirement. So you should know what are the probabilities of the occurrence of various capacity states, and therefore the probabilities of occurrence of these various outage states, and therefore what are the probabilities of occurrence of various loads. You know, there is a load variation, or maybe on a daily basis or over a year, and therefore trying to convolve, trying to use generation and load to figure out what is the reliability index for the generation system. So that's a capacity outage quantity table that we are looking at. So let's say you have n identical independent generating units, all having same parameters. You know, they can be different. So by now you probably understand what is failure rates and so on. So failure rate in terms of the frequency of failures that can happen, which is normalized with respect to the population and time, and therefore you have these failure rates. So n identical generating units, all having same parameters, same transmission rates. Obviously, they are. When we say reliability, we mean that these units can be repaired and they can be down from time to time. So you have a repair and a generation, both a repair and a failure rate, both. So the probability of occurrence of any state where R units have failed out of N, you know, using the binomial theorem, you know how to calculate the probability if R units have failed out of N. So what is the state probability, you know? So now in terms of reliability, as far as the repairable systems are concerned, we refer to them as availability. For repairable systems, when we say reliability, we basically mean availability. Okay, so but availability may not be so attractive for engineers because we are all the time worried about outages and failures, because that is what impacts our life. And therefore, we talk about unavailabilities and we talk about outage rates. So outage rates means unavailability. So you have availability and unavailability. So the unavailability of various capacities, you know, will lead to losses of load. And therefore, we are interested in trying to find out what is the loss of load probability where there is a certain possibility that various states of generation can exist, certain states in the sense that there can be certain outages, and therefore there can be certain capacity states of generation. And then therefore, when you look at the load, which also has a variation, therefore trying to convolve the two and trying to come out with certain indices which relate to the hierarchical level one. So capacity outage quality table is what we are considering now. So frequency of occurrence of a state, frequency calculations, you know, we won't go into the derivation of all these. So you have frequency of occurrence of a state and then probability of occurrence. So probability and frequency. So they can be computed. Let's look at a three generation unit generating system. So you have three generating units, which all the three of them are up, then either of them could be down. So, you know, the first one could be down, the second one could be down, or the third one could be down. So you could have states in which one of the unit have failed, and here two units are operational, okay? Two units are operational. But you can label these states as 1, 2, 3, 4. So state 2 means two units are operational, the second and third. The third means the first and the third is operational. The fourth state is first and second are operational. If they are identical, then there is a way to merge these states to the same capacity states. Likewise, once you are in this state, there can be another unit which will be down. So two units are down, one is up. Here also two units are down, one is up. Here also two units are down, one is up. Likewise, we have three units which is down. Here two units are down, one is up. Now this unit can also fail. Then you can get into a state in which all are down. So you can have a state in which all the three are up or all the three are down, one is down. You know, in all these states, one is down, one unit is down. In all these states, two units are down. Okay, so these are the various states of the system, and you are interested in figuring out what is the probabilities of these states, what is the frequency of occurrence of these states, and so on. So let's take an example which has four generating units, each with 50 megawatt units, and which has an unavailability of 4%. That means 96% of the time, each of these generators are typically available, and and 4% of the time for which they are down for repair and maintenance and so on. Could be preventive, could be planned, could be unplanned. But on the average, 4% of the time they are down for maintenance. So 96% available. And we want to obtain the capacity outage probability table. That means what are the various capacities in the generating system and what are the probabilities associated with this generation capacity. So this is what we want to evaluate. Okay, so you have states in which you will have, because there are four generating units, each having 50 megawatt. So if one is down, you'll be in a state of 150 megawatt. If nothing is out, then you are having the entire capacity at your disposal. If two of the units are down, then you have 100 megawatt. If three of the units are down, you have 50 megawatt. If all the units are down, you have 0 megawatts. So from none of the units are down to all of the units are down, it ranges from 200 to 100. So this is capacity in. So what is capacity out? Capacity out means 200 is the full capacity. So there is nothing which is out. There is no outage. Here one of the unit is down. So 50 is out and 150 is available. So likewise, if two units are down, 100 is out, and therefore 100 is available because the total capacity is 200. Likewise, if three are down, so you have 150 out, 50 in. And if you have all of them down, then 200 is out and you have zero down, zero in. So nothing is there. No, it doesn't have any capacity at all. And therefore, we are interested in looking at the load. What will be the probability that these capacity states will be able to meet the load, which also has a variation. That means it has a probability associated with the various load states. So using those, you saw those binomial theorem and combinations of those various working units and failed units. You remember this expression? No, this is unavailable, unavailability 4%, 96% availability. So you can calculate these probabilities. Okay. So these probabilities can be calculated. So for zero capacity, this is the probability. For 50 megawatt capacity, this is the probability. For 100 megawatt, this is the capacity. 150, this is the capacity. 200, this is the capacity. Those availabilities high, 96%. So there is a certain chance that you may have 200 megawatts. And this is the problem. But it is also possible that all the four of them could fail at the same time. And this is the probability of such occurrence. That means having 0 megawatt in the capacity of the generating system, you know, the probability is so much. So cumulative probabilities can also be obtained, you know, cumulative probabilities. That means the capacity is 150 or more, 100 or more, 50 or more, 0 or more, okay? So you can obtain these cumulative probabilities also. So rather than the state probabilities, it may be advantageous to know what is the cumulative probability. That means the probability of having at least 50 megawatts, at least 100 megawatts, at least 150 megawatts, a probability of having 200 megawatts, or probability of having at least zero. That means there is something which is being generated all the time. Okay, so basically when you want to do all that, you need to work on a state space problem. So it's a Markov model in which what are the various states. If you recall, we had states in which there is no units which are out, full capacity is there, zero is out, one unit is out. So that means 50 is out. So you are left with 150. And two units are out, 100 is out. Therefore, you are left with 100. Three units are out. Therefore, you are left with 50. Four units are out. Therefore, you are left with 0 megawatt. So you have how many states? Five possible states. Okay, you have four generating units, but you get five states because you can also have a state in which all are working, and you can also have a state in which none are working. So it all amounts to five states. So you have 0 out, 1 out, 2 out, 3 out, 4 out. 0 out, that means any of the four can fail. Okay, any of the four can fail. So it can go into a state of 1 out. And therefore, if the failure rate is lambda, so this means 4 lambda. And when you are in this state, 1 is out. So obviously, this would be attended to. And therefore, there is a repair rate which is associated with it. And therefore, it would take you back to the state in which all of them are working. Where one of them is not working, but if they are repaired, then you will get into a state in which all of them are working. Likewise, once you are in this state, you may experience another failure. So you'll get into a state of 2 of the units are out. And then either of the 2 units could get repaired. Okay. Repair can start on either of them, both of them. And then therefore one of them may come into service, become operational. So you may move from 2 out to a state 1 out. And here since 3 of them are available, either of them could fail. So you have 3 lambda and either of the 2 could get repaired. Therefore you have 1, therefore you have 2. Once you are in this state, then you have 2 out, 2 in. So either of the 2 can fail, in which you can get into a state in which 3 are out. Then either of the 3 can get repaired. If you have adequate repair facilities, then you'll get into a state in which 2 are out, one of them will get repaired. Or if 3 of them are out, and another failure happens, then you'll get into a state in which 4 are out, and then either of the 4 can get repaired, and you'll get into a state in which 3 are out. So this is a state space diagram, and these are the transition rates from one state to another, from 0 to 1, 4 lambda, from 1 to 0, mu, from 1 to 2, 3 lambda, from 2 to 1, 2 mu, from 2 lambda, 2 out to 3 out, 2 lambda, from 3 out to 2 out, 3 mu, from 3 out to 4 out, lambda, from 4 out to 3 out, 4 mu. So this is a state space diagram. And therefore, you can find out the state probabilities in terms of these transition rates. Okay? So you can find out the probability of the system being in a state in which 0 is out, 1 is out, or 2 is out, or 3 is out, or 4 is out. Okay, so but then there can be various complex problems. You know, for example, this is a simple problem, but you may get states which have, for example, here there are all equal capacity, all generating capacities are equal, 50 megawatt, but you don't have unequal capacities. You may have unequal capacities, for example, in the other example. Maybe we may get some time to see. There is 20 megawatt and 40 megawatt, one generating unit. 20 megawatt, 3 units, 40 megawatt, 1 unit. So 40 megawatt is out, so you have a state of 60 megawatt, but it's one generator which is out. But you may also have states in which 2 generators are out, each of them are 20 megawatt. So you again end up with 60 megawatt. So you have two different states, two different capacity states. So the capacity states are same, but these are two different states. The probabilities that you may get a system state in which 2 generators of 20 megawatt each are out, you may get a certain probability, which may be different from the priority of a state in which, say, the generating unit, which was 40 megawatt, is out. And therefore, how do you work with these two different states, although they have the same capacity? So there may be situations in which you may want to merge the capacity, equal capacity states. They are different states, but equal capacities. So, because when you want to work out the state probabilities, you are looking at the capacity states. Okay. So you are having a state in which 100 megawatt is there, 80 megawatt is there, 60 megawatt is there, 40 megawatt is there, 20 megawatt is there, 0 megawatt is there. So you may have states in which two different generators have failed and a state, one generator has failed, but the capacities are same. So you need to merge these two states to get an idea about the state probability associated with that capacity. So you have some theory and some mathematics which are involved in trying to merge these two states, merge the two of them. So you have, you know, these are different states of the system, maybe equal capacity states, but then you can merge them and then have the associated transition rates computed. So these computations come handy when the capacity states are same. They may be different states of the system, but the capacity states are same. And therefore, you want to combine these two and come up with a single state of the system with their transition rates as well. So you can merge the states. There is some mathematics which is associated with it. Okay. So I'll quickly show, because now we are almost coming to the end of it. So let's say a generation system, as I mentioned, three units having a capacity of 20 megawatt and one unit having a capacity of 40 megawatt. So we need to obtain the capacity outage quality table with certain failure rates and repair rates. So as you can see, the units, although they are different capacities, but they may have the same facilities and therefore they may experience the same failure rates and repair rates. So let's say the unavailability is 4% and the availability is 96%. So let's look at this is what we discussed about the various units which are having unequal capacities. Three units of 20 megawatt, one unit of 40 megawatt. Okay. So look at the state space diagram. It explodes into such a huge one. You know, in the previous case, we had such a small state space diagram. You see, only five states were. I mean, if equal capacities are there, the number of states are few. But if unequal capacities are there, then the states can be too many. For example, this is a state in which 100 megawatt, which has first, second, and third generator of 20 megawatt each, and fourth generator of 40 megawatt. So you can be in a state in which first unit is out, or second unit is out, or third unit is out. Each of these units are 20 megawatt, or you could be into a state in which fourth unit is out, which is 40 megawatt. So from 100 megawatt, here you end up with 80, 80, 80, but here this is 60. Likewise, yet another unit can be out, 20 megawatt unit. So this can be 60. Likewise, this can be 60. But if the fourth unit is out, then you are left with 40. Likewise, here you'll be left with 60. And here you'll be left with 40. And here you'll be left with 40. So here you have a 60. Here you have a 60. And here you have a 60. Here you have a 60 capacity. And here you have 60 capacity. Here also you have 60 capacity. So these three states need to be merged. And then you also need to merge the 40 capacities. So this state, and this state have to be merged. So likewise, you may require merger of states. So it will then reduce to equal capacity states. You know, they are all equal capacity states, and therefore they can be merged. So if you merge them, you know, you can look at the various capacities of various states in the system. How many states in the system were there? Four, then five, four. So five, four, nine, four, 13, to 15. So look at these states. So you have 15 states, but different capacities. So here 4, then here you have 6, then here you have 5, 6, 5, 11, 4, 15, and 1, 16. Okay, so 16 states of the system. So in which you have all of them working 100, none of them working 0, and then in between 20 to 80, depending upon how many of them are failed. 3 of them have failed and left with 20. Okay, here a fourth unit has failed, although 3 of them are working, so you'll be left with 40. So likewise, you know, likewise you end up with various capacity states, but these equal capacity states have to be merged. For example, 2, 4, 3, 4, and 1, 2, 3 can be merged. Likewise, these three states can be merged. Then likewise, these are 80 unit capacity states, they can be merged. Then you have 60 unit capacity states, so then they can be merged, generating a system with 60 megawatt capacity states. So equal capacity states can be merged. Okay, so these are identical capacity states we discussed. So likewise, you'll end up again with a fewer state. That means from 100, you can come to 80. If either one or two or three, either one of the three generators with 20 megawatt, they fail, then you can move from 100 to 80. Or if the 40 megawatt generator failed, you'll come to 60. Then again from 80, you can come to 60 or you can go to 40. Then again from 60, you can go to 40 or you can go to 20. Then again from 40, you can go to 20 or you can go to 0. Then they can, repairs can happen. You know, 20 megawatt can be repaired or the 40 megawatt. So you'll get this state space problem. You'll get this state space model. And likewise, therefore, you can compute the probabilities of these states. And then, you know, you get something equivalent to a capacity outage probability table. Okay, so you look at the probability computation of these states. Okay, then merger of these states. Okay, merging of these states. So then there is some mathematics which is related to the merger of these states. So then transitions between the various states, the merger, the frequencies, computation of the probability, frequency, durations, and so on. Okay, and then equivalent transition rates. So these are some computations associated with it. So for example, 100 to 80 megawatt. So this is 1, 2, 3. These are all 80 megawatts. So you can compute, you know, you can merge all these three states and then have one transition rate from 100 to 80 and then from 80 to 100. So 100 to 80, 80 to 100. So you can calculate them using those expressions that we have discussed. Likewise, you can calculate all the transition rates. Okay, so from various states to other states, so merger of states, then transition rates, those can be computed. Okay, so it's a complex calculation, requires a lot of time, and therefore you can develop what is the capacity outage probability table for, you know, unequal capacities of generating units. So you can calculate them, and therefore you can go ahead and calculate the frequency. The frequency, cumulative frequency, is that a certain capacity will be, occurrence outage will happen, and you know, the capacity outage probabilities, cumulative probabilities, frequencies, durations, and so on. So you can calculate the loss of load probabilities and the loss of load expectation. So these computations are intensive. There is a load variation also. We looked at the generation variation, the probabilities and the frequencies. So likewise, you have a load duration. Then you convolve the generation and the load together, find out the various states, find out the various states of the system, find out their probabilities, find out the frequencies, the durations, and so on. So these computations are quite involved, and therefore they require a lot of time. So you have LOLP, loss of load, loss of expected amount of energy not supplied, okay, loss of load expectation. Then you have variation of load and so on, daily peak loads, then compute the capacity outage priority table, loss of load priorities, loss of energy expectation, expected energy not served, okay, the merger of the variation of the daily load, you know, it leads to various states, then the failures of various generating units and unequal capacities, they lead to various states, then try to merge them, get one complete state space model. So this is just for the load, various states of the load, okay, various states of the load, try to calculate the probabilities and so on, then various capacities and the various loads. This is the generation model. So COPT for the generation system, then combine generation and load model, okay, you combine both the generation and the load, and then you get multiple states. So you see there we were getting some fewer states, 15, 16 states. Here you will get so many, many states, because the load can exist in various states, the capacity generating system can exist in various states. So you are trying to take combinations of both the generation and the load, and then you get all the states, then try to figure out what is the probability of these states. Then likewise, you compute the frequencies, you compute the durations and so on. So this is a quite an involved computation and would take a hell lot of time. Okay, so I don't think we can really do any justice to that. And then compute the probabilities and frequencies of these margin states. Some examples to illustrate that idea. Okay. Okay, so I think we are done. We already have now exceeded probably. Have we exceeded the time or do we have some time? Yeah, we have exceeded the time. So if there are any questions, we can cover. Otherwise, I am done. Okay, so are there any questions? Are there any questions? If there are no questions, then I'm closing it. I hope I have been able to convey you the basic concepts and the complexities of the mathematical calculations that are associated with it. We were in level one only, hierarchical level one. We try to understand the various indices, both adequacy and security indices, and then also get a sneak peek into how these computations can happen through some examples. So, okay, so shall I close it?
Sir, there are questions in the chat box.
Let me see. I'm not getting the chat box here. Where is the chat box?
Sir, you click on that window, this one window, which is just adjacent to here. It is showing the meeting.
Where is it? The first one which shows the presenting.
Yes, you just expand it, sir. That arrow. Meeting now, I mean, which is showing this meeting now and this arrow. minimize and maximize button. Just maximize it, sir. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, right. Now I can see the chat. See, we have not really gone to the level in which we can discuss, you know, multiple sources of energy and then try to discuss the interruptions due to the energy sources. Are the system reliability indices prioritized, modified? See, the basic idea of generation, transmission, distribution is same. Transmission and distribution network is the generation sources which you are changing, the solar, wind and tidal power, and therefore they may have different characteristics in terms of interruptions, you know, both the solar in terms of the time and then the season, and the wind depending upon the time of the day, depending upon the season, likewise the tidal power. So they may have certain capacity states which are different, and so you may need to calculate them individually and then probably try to get an overview in terms of the total generated capacity and the transmission network and the distribution network. Of course, they could remain the same. So the generation capacity outage probability tables have to convolve differently with the transmission network, because the capacity outage probability table for each of them could be different. So it is definitely a much more elaborate and complex task. In an offshore marine power system, what are the most critical system design reliability indices? See, whether it is offshore or whether it is a marine power system, so the generating units would typically, you know, where you are not basically looking at the transmission network, then you are simply looking at the load and the generation. So therefore you may need to know what are the generating units and develop a capacity outage probability table for the generating units, knowing their capacities and knowing their outages. You know, you can generate a capacity outage probability table, and then you have a certain load requirement which may not have too much of fluctuation if it is type of system, and therefore you can still calculate the design, you can still calculate the reliability indices or the power supply system. You can calculate definitely, but in the cases that you are discussing, you are largely trying to discuss about indices which relate only to the generation and to the load. It doesn't take into the level 2 or level 3, you know. So most of the indices which may be of interest as far as the ones which we are discussing are level 1 indices. Of course, what is ultimately received at the customer's end is also what matters, and how much would it how expensive it is going to turn out to be depends upon the generation as well. But as far as the reliability aspects are concerned, largely it would depend more on the generation systems that you are considering. If you are not really taking much uncertainties into the transmission and the distribution network. Okay. Okay then, so if there are no further questions, at least maybe there are some other questions. I think everybody seems to be concerned about multiple power generating sources. So do they include human reliability evaluation? So human reliability evaluation, when you are looking at the maintenance aspect of it, there is a certain human error possibility. Now the human error possibility, if you want to factor in, then trying to figure out what outages and downtimes can occur by factoring in the human reliability. So you can use certain tools which can handle critical combinations of failure, you know, both technical as well as they can also factor in human errors. So typically, say a faulty analysis will be able to accommodate human errors and critical combinations of failure. So that can tell you about the overall outage of a particular unit or a generation plant. So that you can factor in through certain tools like the faulty analysis, and then you compute that, and then you can factor it into the availability of the generating units, and then accordingly develop the capacity outage priority table and convolve it with the load. Okay, so is there anything else? Okay, then if there is nothing else, I think I already taken more time. I'm signing off.
Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, thank you. Take care. Bye.
Thank you, sir.